hello, it's me again. Totally 180 degrees from the last panel.
Great.
We are here to talk about Julie's green room, which is amazing, even if you don't have little ones. And before I intro the amazing team and stars, let's watch some of Julie's green room.
Welcome, my greenies. To the stage.
To the stage!
This is gonna be the best workshop ever!
Copy that.
We're going to be learning about the magic of the performing arts.
His name is Hugo.
Every theater ought to have a duck.
It's time to start our acting class. First, there's listening. Super important.
Mm-hmm. What did he say?
Are you ready to sing your hearts out for Miss Julie?
In harmony!
Fire up the bus, Gus. These kids are going to Broadway.
That's so cool!
My job is to make people laugh.
Are you good at it?
Am I good at it? I don't know. What have you heard?
All right, ready, everyone?
Yeah.
Everybody, come on out.
What are we gonna learn today?
We are going to build Mashup the Musical.
Everything in between.
Awesome!
Remember, every part, big or small, is important to our play.
Best friends make the best team.
We can do anything, dance, we can do it. We
can you guys ready for your big night?
Totally!
Put it all together, we can do anything.
It is my honor to introduce Dame Goddess Julie Andrews.
Mom. How's that?
Poor mom.
Mom. Hello, everybody.
Emma Walton Hamilton.
Hi, everyone.
Mom. Yeah.
And Lisa Henson.
Mom.
Hello.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for being here. I want to start from the beginning. Tell me how you came up with the idea for the show, because it feels different from other shows we've seen.
Well, that's great. Thank you from your lips. Mm-hmm. I've long wanted to do a program on the arts, to convey the joy of the arts to children and to families, and to just specialize in that. And Lisa has been a longtime friend and said one day, I wish we could do something together, and we've been talking about things, and you suddenly said something about, well, can you remember what you said, Lisa?
Yeah, we wanted to work with Julie, and producing partner Hallie Stanford and I thought, what would be our dream of where we would want to see Julie on television? We thought if she had a kind of magical theater and a group of kids that she had brought into the fold. And so we pitched that back to
Julie.
Well,
the minute I heard the idea, I thought, that's it. That's what I really wanted to do. And so thanks to you and the wonderful Henson family and those fantastic puppets and the incredible puppeteers. And then my M came aboard and we came up with the basic outline for the whole show and wrote the first and last script. And Emma was producer. It was a labor of love, I can tell you that, and a family one too.
And thanks to Netflix especially.
Yes, and then Netflix came aboard and we couldn't be happier.
I was wondering if you could talk a little bit about this the tone of the show, because even though I have two kids, they were asleep when I watched it, and I loved it. And so it's one of those shows that even as an adult, there are so many references that are going to fly over kids' heads, and then there are so many other things that are going to resonate so much more strongly for younger viewers. And I was wondering if you could talk
about... Well, there's a sort of Winnie the Pooh analogy, really. You know that. Well, you take that, Emma.
Well, that wonderful experience that you have when you're reading, for instance, a beloved book with a young child, and there is a level at which the young child is receiving the story and the characters and the nuances, and then there's another level of sophistication and humor and hopefully a little added insight and pleasure for the adults reading it. And so we hoped to achieve the same balance with the show. That was our goal.
Both of those things apply.
Yeah, I mean, and it really is, although it is a preschool show, I think we all feel that it's really a family show. It's a show that we hope families will watch together across multiple generations.
Grandparents will sit down and mom will say, I'll come and sit and watch this with you and so on.
There's really something for everyone.
I think the format is a little bit of a nostalgic throwback in a way. Like perhaps you remembered, you know, variety shows and The Muppet Show and that combination of guest stars and puppets and actors singing together that you don't really see that often anymore.
But the wonder is, in this case, Lisa, I think, at least for me and for Em, is that it is all about the arts. I supposedly run a theater and I teach classes about the arts to children, and in this case, the puppets. And there are master classes, which of course are our guest performers each episode, and it just couldn't be more the way I would love to present that joy.
Well, I think with you know, arts education funding being cut all over the place, also, did this feel like something, you know, on some level that you felt like I need to do this, I need to do my part with this?
Absolutely.
We are huge arts advocates as a family and as individuals, and I actually, part of my background is that I founded and ran my own Equity Regional Theater, and actually basically lived Miss Julie's life teaching performing arts workshops to kids through our theater and running the Young
and
Audience
still
Programming.
Do
and
stuff.
Yeah, Emma's the real life Julie. It's a bit, a little bit of a role reversal.
So through that experience and my ongoing teaching to kids the arts, we know firsthand how incredibly important it is. And it is always the first thing to be cut. And
once again, we
find ourselves in a situation where the arts are potentially in peril. And, you know, and yet we know that it teaches kids communication skills. It teaches them critical thinking skills. The arts provide them with opportunities to learn about collaboration
and
teamwork.
And it's a bridge between countries and
cultures, socioeconomic. It levels the playing field in a way that, you know, very few other things
do. And you can find your identity through the arts. If you're shy, or
it teaches us about ourselves. It teaches tolerance and empathy. I mean, you can go on and on and on. It's so important.
Which is a lot of what we see with the different and diversity on many levels of the puppets in the show. And Lisa, I was wondering if you could talk about how you decided what kind of personalities to include among the puppets in the show.
Well, we wanted a good mixture, you know, different types of kids. There's actually one of the boy characters, he's a pianist and he's in a wheelchair, so we have all kinds of diversity in the casting.
And I love that it's raised in the episode. Immediately one of the kids says, oh, are you always in that wheelchair?
And are you always in a wheelchair?
And it's such a beautiful and kind of honest moment, and I was really happy that it was written in.
It actually pays off in an incredible episode where Robert Fairchild and Tyler Peck, the ballet dancers, come. And not only do the boys in the group learn that ballet is not just for girls, but also Hank, the boy in the wheelchair, has a chance to participate, and he does great, of course. So, you know, we definitely wanted a good showing of diversity amongst the kids. Of course, we design the kids. We don't cast them, so to speak, but we sort of cast them by designing them. We worked with a great character designer.
That was
Alana
day.
Allen. Yeah. She does beautiful, cute children. So we're very proud of the designs, and Julie and Emma actually went to our puppet workshop constantly during the
I think it was one of the best
during
days
the build.
That we had on the show was going there,
And I think we were so pleasantly surprised that Julie took such an interest as to pick the actual fabrics of every garment that the characters are wearing.
Because
she had an image in her mind how they should look, and, you know, it was easy to kind of follow through, and they actually all look incredible together, I think, because you had that vision.
Well,
you were like, that hem needs to be 1 inch shorter over
the jacket, just a tiny bit longer because her pocket should be filled with tools.
But you can imagine, too, and we went to the creature shop, but we also kept getting these packages in the mail, and it would be, you know, 16 different foam samples, which were skin tones that we would be choosing from, and then fabric swatches and hair samples. And it was
Which ones have eyes and eyelids that close, and or just eyes that stay open? And it's and then the way that the puppeteers utilize those puppet. It's just...
It's extraordinary.
I am in awe. They are unsung heroes because you never see the puppeteers, and they're adorable people and special inside. They've got a kind of... I have to digress for a second. If we had a family come onto the set any day, I'd notice one or two of the puppeteers, and they'd walk over with the puppet and address the kids. And the kids never looked at the puppeteer, always at the puppet. And it was so sweet to warm them up, to bring them in. And I don't think adults or kids or anybody, that nobody doesn't like puppets.
Yeah. Maybe some people don't like
no,
them.
No, I can't
like clowns. You know, there's going to be some people that don't like
them. Well, they're like
clowns
ours,
are way
that's
creepier.
For sure. Yeah. I mean, look at them. How could you not love that?
They are wonderful, and I love what you said about ballet and stuff. And there's also a really wonderful moment where there's a girl who, you know, who's in, you know, one of the greenies who wants to be a princess, and she gets cast as something else. And
they're cast as the ogre.
As the ogre. And they're all, there are these moments that it's so important. As a parent, I think it's so important to challenge kids' perceptions, whatever it is, based on, you know, whatever it is, gender, ethnicity, race, you know, and it does a really nice job with that.
Yeah.
Yeah, that story, I love that story too, because the two girls decide to trade parts. Yeah. And they have to be told by Julie that you can't...
No, by Julian, actually.
Oh, right, by her assistant.
Just about to mention. Go on, Lisa.
That's not really how it works. You know, they've been cast, these were the right parts, and then the girl who got the ogre role realizes actually it's the biggest role in the... In the show.
Yoga role is the one that you can really pull out all the stops and so on. But we have I have in the series a wonderful assistant named Gus, who is played by Julian Joiello, and I know
he's amazing.
My granddaughter, your daughter, just fell in love with him instantly. Yeah. And I think a lot of kids
sings like an angel.
He has a great voice, and he's such fun and adorable.
Plays guitar and ukulele. And
yeah, and as you see, we also have a duck. And every theater should have a duck, believe me, this duck.
And you'll find out why.
Yeah.
Yes, you will. And I believe we also have, brace yourselves, because we do have a special guest.
Really?
We do. I don't know
I'm coming.
Somebody's coming.
Yeah.
Spike!
It's Spike!
Spike!
Lisa.
Hello,
my name is Julie.
Hi, darling.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm good.
We missed you. Where have you been?
I miss you too.
Mike is our writer. He writes the show that we eventually put on.
Hi.
Spike loves writing and books. Spike, were you, when you got to meet Miss Julie, were you like, oh my God?
Yeah, I was. I was like, oh my God. Yeah. No, it was really fun. We learned about a lot of different things about theater and dancing and music.
Spike, was there any one thing that you enjoyed learning about more than something else?
Well, I had always liked writing and being a writer, but I learned how to, the word was collaborate with people and actually, you know, write a song together.
That was great, that song, by the way.
What a great song you wrote,
thank
too.
You.
Yeah,
thank
yeah
you.
We had an episode with Sarah Bareilles where she worked with the kids to write their own songs. And the two boys are teamed up, and they have a little bit different views of how it should go. And it's actually a really good episode about the real difficulty of collaborating, but how worthwhile it is.
We were just talking before we came on stage about a day when Joshua Bell, comes to teach us about music and orchestras, and he conducts a little bit with our greenies, who are...
He was really good.
Wasn't he?
Yeah.
And... He, at the very, we try to go for a wow moment at the end of each show where our greenies, hopefully our audiences too, go, oh, that's what it's all about. And he plays the most beautiful piece, a variation on Yankee Doodle, isn't it?
Yankee Doodle.
And Josh Bell is a perfectionist. They say I am, but he's far worse than I am. And he kept saying, oh, God, just flubbed it a tiny bit at the end. Could I do it again? And we were all just sitting back going, go ahead. Wonderful.
He played that song 100 times.
Just
Almost
about that.
100 times.
Yeah.
Well, you mentioned a couple of the guest stars. I wanted to just, I mean, in addition to Sarah Bareilles, Lisa, who you mentioned, and Joshua Bell, Idina Menzel, Alec Baldwin, Titus Burgess, Ellie Kemper, Josh Groban, yep. Stomp. I mean, there's so many.
Bill Owen, great, wonderful Carol, who is just marvelous.
Mm-hmm. And Chris Colfer.
David Hyde Pierce.
And Carol Burnett.
And my chum, Carol Burnett.
Oh, yes. Well, first of all, how did you kind of come up with a dream list? And is it like...
It was a dream list. I mean, everybody just... some of them we knew about, some we didn't, but people kind of fell into place and had a ball the day that they came to
work. Once we knew essentially what the art, because each episode of the series focuses on a different art form, a different performing art form, and once we knew what the focus of each episode was going to be,
that was the hardest part.
Then it was like, okay, who would be the dream person to teach kids that?
And almost everybody wanted to do the show. It was just whether their schedule would work, because we were just shooting in a very limited period of time. But we felt so lucky that we had such big guest stars.
You were kind of surprised to see a boy dancer, weren't you, Spike?
A boy dancer?
Yeah.
Yeah, a boy ballet dancer.
Yeah. I remember you weren't too crazy about that, right?
Well, yeah, because I thought ballet dancing was just for girls, but it's not.
Right.
We got to make our own dance. My friend Hank and I made our own dance.
That's Hank, who's in a wheelchair.
Yeah.
But he can still dance.
But you know, I'm glad I didn't have to wear a tutu, though. Because that was the first thing I said, do we have to wear tutus? And he said no.
Yeah.
So.
Did any of the guest stars pass out from excitement at getting to, you know, maybe duet with Julie Andrews?
I saw a bit of that.
Well, Alec
maybe
Baldwin,
they didn't show it to you, but
Alec
I saw
Alec Baldwin, who is an old friend, and you know, it wasn't so much about that, but he was very excited because it happened that he had just 2 weeks previous recorded a duet with Barbara Streisand for her new album.
So in a
for
month,
someone who doesn't sing.
Yes, he didn't think he could sing. We did very well.
He was good.
Yeah, he was good, wasn't he?
He was thrilled to be doing a duet.
Yeah, it's a lovely song. It's a silly song, but great fun.
It's a great song. It's one of my favorite songs because it has all of these, what I was saying earlier about all these references that adults, there's a reference to like Stella, there's a Fanny Bryce reference, like all these things, like, you
adult,
know.
Adult
Spike, fair. You might not have understood some of those things, you know.
No. Nope.
But they got it anyway, I think, didn't you?
Well, I do now.
Yeah.
Because I watch the show.
Julie, do you still get the thrill from singing these new songs on the show?
I do. I don't sing them in the way that I used to sing, as everybody knows, but I managed to sort of I've still got a few bass notes.
To sound beautiful.
You sound incredible.
Yeah, I belt them out in some way or another, or sing, speak, or...
And we actually have an original song in almost, not every single episode, but almost every episode has an original song written by, you know, all kinds of different wonderful Broadway composer lyricist teams.
Spike, what part do you play in the play at the end?
In the play, I play a wizard.
You play the wizard, that's right,
I have a big wizard hat and a wand.
And you look great.
What did you think about wearing that costume, Spike?
Huh?
What was it like wearing that costume, the wizard costume?
It was cool. Miss Julie made it for me.
Oh, right.
Yeah, I made a lot of the costumes.
She was up all night making the costumes.
Sewing away, yeah.
Driven by her nice cup of tea that kept you awake.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That you guys kept bringing to her.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's always a cup of tea on the set for me, on my desk. I'm very happy about that.
You mentioned Edna Breitfeld, who's a character that we hear about quite a bit without seeing. She was, you know, I was wondering if this was just going to be like a, you know, just for parents to see if, like, you keep catching every reference to her, who is a benefactor. Maybe you can tell people about who plays Edna Breitfeld.
We hear about this benefactress who's coming to see our show. And in case she, hopefully, we're hoping that she'll donate some money because all the arts need funding, as we quietly remind our public. But then Mrs. Edna Breitfeld, think Fulbright would be probably better. Mrs. Edna Breitfeld finally shows up, and it is my chum Carol Burnett, and she's the only one that doesn't come as herself. She comes as Edna. And she keeps asking me to call her Edna, dear, but I can't. I have to call her Mrs. Fulbright because she's awesome.
Brightful.
Mrs. Brightful, I mean, because she's so awesome. And she's decked out in this orange suit and these, her first entrance is through double doors, and she just goes, howdy, and I cracked up because my chum Carol came in with all the bling in the world and this orange suit and this wig, and she was brilliant. So,
yes. And she had a bad duck allergy, right?
Oh, yes, right. She's allergic to feathers, which of course with a duck in the theater is not too good.
Yeah. It's bad.
Yeah.
Now, when Carol Burnett shows up, is it like the script is out the window? You just let her do
her
thing?
It's a little bit of all of it. She's exactly what we hoped for. And then what she adds is so brilliant. It's just trying to keep up with her, really. Yeah.
I'm sorry, Lisa, were you going to say?
No, I was just going to mention that we do have a little thread running through all the episodes. So it's, they follow on each other in a very gentle way because the first episode is the beginning of the class. By the end, they're putting their show together that uh-huh. they've written, that they've composed the music for, and they've put it all together, and they put it on at the very end. So that was actually unique for us doing in kids, as we have not done a serialized show.
So we're building always to the show.
It's very Netflix.
What was that called again?
Serializing?
An arc.
Oh, an arc. That's right.
Yeah. An arc.
I had an arc.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. All the characters have an arc.
We all had an arc.
Yes.
Yeah, and they all decided what they wanted to play and how they wanted to play and mm-hmm. what they wanted to say.
Right.
And we put it all together. I mean,
you got to watch all of them to get the
King
arc.
Harold was very fond of waffles, right? And so there was a special waffle dance in the kingdom, which the puppets suggested, and we had mm-hmm. to go along with it.
Mm-hmm. Do you have thoughts about, since they will be released and you could theoretically binge watch this or, you know,
you will binge watch.
You will binge. Oh, okay. That's an order from Spike.
From his lips. Yes. He can say it. I can't.
I mean, do you have thoughts about, you know, how you want people to consume it? Do you want them to do like one and then wait another few days?
Any way they like, as long as they turn in, tune in, I think, would be wonderful.
All of them every day.
All of them every day.
Over again, right?
Well, maybe maybe some of our fans might, yes. Mm-hmm. But it doesn't matter. It is, what is so amazing is that when you're working with Spike, for instance, all you see, as you can see today, all you see is the puppet. You see Spike, and you see Fizz, and you see, I've got to remember all their names now.
Perry.
Yeah.
Hank.
Riley.
And the duck is called Hugo. And Hugo.
And you have a Toby.
Have a little puppy that's called Toby. And
he's really cute.
Every one of them contributes something. And I don't literally see the puppeteers, but you really only focus on the puppets. And it's kind of amazing. It was true with Kermit in the old days.
Yeah. That being said, we do have amazing puppeteers on this
show. You do.
Oh, my gosh. There's a little Avenue Q reunion for people.
Three of the four original cast members of Avenue Q are in the cast. And then we have wonderful Sesame Street puppeteers. And we also used a lot of behind-the-scenes talent from Sesame Street. Joey Mazzarino, the Sesame writer and director, directed all the episodes.
He was really cool.
He's really cool.
He told us what to do all the time.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
So we had, you know, great talent on that side. And I'm so happy you mentioned Kermit because Julie and my dad were pretty close friends and they guested on each other's shows in the heyday of variety TV shows, right?
Indeed.
Did this take you back at all to doing? I mean, you did the
primetime
shows.
I've always loved it anyway, but I met your dad when he was almost just beginning. I mean, he came on one show that I did and just captivated us all, and Sesame Street hadn't begun then.
You were a guest on Sesame.
I was.
Special,
I did two
as
specials.
Well as the Muppet Show.
Yeah, yeah.
One of the great Muppet Show episodes of all time.
And then
the
I wrote a song for Kermit and for me. I wrote a song called "When You Were a Tadpole and I Was a Fish."
Right.
Yeah. We knew we loved each other. Episodes.
Oh, so good. I want to open it up to questions in case anyone has while I become a puddle up here thinking about that.
I've probably told you everything, but if you have any questions, please ask.
It's kind of hard to see.
I know.
Is anybody holding up a hand?
Yes.
Yes. Please, this gentleman. Yes.
In doing this show, did it bring back memories of you guys? Any experiences with puppets besides the Henson puppets or other childhood memories that you've referenced to bring in and become a part of the show? That
memories of my theater experiences I used from time to time, things that mattered to me and I thought would matter to children in the theater. I did address those. Can you think?
We called them Julie's Gems.
Julie.
So in the same way that the guest would have a what we were calling the wow moment.
Yeah.
We always had a moment in each episode that we called Julie's Gem, where she would say something that you had told us. We always would script it into the script. Something you had imparted to us. Like, for instance, in the voice episode, when you said everybody's voice is a completely different instrument. And it's personal. And, you know, it was just a perfect little moment, and that became a Julie's Gem for the voice episode.
Right.
Yeah.
Also, I think you brought in a great deal of your own background in vaudeville from your youth.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
There's some wonderful
moments.
Clown episode with Bill Irwin. There's a pie fight scene. There's a clowning episode with Julian as well at the beginning of that episode where you drew, I think, a lot on your own.
I did, and then
people were always surprised.
Yeah, she does slapstick.
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. You know, what you were weaned on, basically.
Yeah. It was great fun. The more I got to perform with the puppets and with the guests too.
There's like a teeny little moment in the episode about with the ogre or princess where you say something about how you wanted to play Robin Hood when you were younger, but you got cast as something else.
As one of the spear holders.
Yes. Yeah. Exactly. And I was wondering. I wonder, like, how much of your life.
All, you know, many memories, and I started at such an early age, and it did bring in quite a lot of those reflections, and I hope, well, maybe people can spot some of them, but you can, I know.
Well, Julie also invented the duck character, which is the most absurd element of the
entire
show. I was
in bed one night, and I suddenly thought, oh, my God, what would happen if, and we assume that our theater is sort of set out, well, we sort of hoped that we would know. It was set out somewhere in the east, near a pond, and so on and so forth. And I thought, what if a duck walked into the theater one day and claimed that he was passionate about the theater, doesn't speak, but Julian, who plays Gus, learned duck at Wesleyan, so he speaks duck very well.
We all got to learn duck by the end.
Yes,
you
and
did.
There's
yeah,
a lot of, what
true.
Did he say? But you get to understand, and he gets to be invaluable. And I say, the kids, the puppets say, well, you can't have a duck in theater. It's ridiculous. And I say, well, theater never discriminates. We have to, at least he has to audition, and let's hear it.
He could do it all, though. He was a singer, dancer.
Yes, he was, and wasn't he great?
Yeah, and he did, like, maintenance stuff, too.
Yep, and washed the stage and skated around it with sponges on his feet.
It was always clean.
The theater benefited a great deal, so I think the duck was very useful.
But you were also very partial to the duck because you personally choreographed his big ballet finale number.
Yeah, I hate to give it away, but I certainly... will. it did occur to me that our beautiful Tyler Peck and Robert Fairchild do this beautiful excerpt from Swan Lake, and that was because I wanted the duck to eventually play the swan in our final show, and so of course he's bent over like this, and the classic solo or pas de deux of the two principals.
He had a nice swan costume.
Yeah, he did, and it is very funny. Yum, bum, dee, dum, da, da, dum, bar-rum. And it's...
So she worked out every step.
Well, sort of. I just knew the piece of music that we ought to hear with that particular piece of choreography, but it's very funny, and it is a surprise, I think.
Yeah. I saw somebody else with a question.
I don't know if I should call you Dame Judy.
No, just Julie.
Julie, hi. Yeah. I'm gushing, sorry. Tell me... What personally do you get from children's stories and the books that you've written? What sort of satisfaction does that give you?
Well, a lot of joy. Working with one's daughter is a gift. You don't expect that very much when she's knee-high and growing up, and suddenly here we are as two equals facing each other and swapping ideas and stories. Also, I think it's where my head is at. It's to do with imagination, theater, visual. I see, you know this, darling, that I see all our stories first in my head visually, as if it were a little. I mean, by that I mean, I write, let's say I write an opening paragraph to get us set up. Well, any show, as you know, or film, begins with either a fanfare or a pastoral moment before the great big explosion that comes on. And it comes from having loved theatre for so long. And I think the joy of writing children's books is that it brings it to them in some way. Do you want to add something to that, darling?
Yeah, I would just add that for, I think the other piece that is so joyful for us about writing for children and now writing and producing television for children is because it is, first and foremost, it is an awesome responsibility to write for other people's children.
It certainly is, yeah.
Because you are putting information and resources and ideas out there, and you have to be able to stand behind them and believe that they are in children's best interests. But it is also, it is ultimately such a joyful place to be creatively, because the difference between writing for children and writing for adults is that in the end, even in YA, even in a book as dark as, let's say, 13 Reasons Why, there is something inherently hopeful. There is, at the end, always in children's literature or in young adult literature, there is some resource given, some hope offered, some through line of championing the human spirit that I don't think necessarily always exists in adult fiction or nonfiction. You can sort of write whatever you want for grown-ups and let them just take the ride if they want to, and, you know, be a freight train crashing and running from the finish,
but using the
beautifully
words,
written or whatever, you know, adults will do that. Yeah. But children's literature is an inherently hopeful and lovely place to be, and yet at the same time, a huge responsibility, and as such, it makes it very, very difficult to do, and it's
harder
like
than most people realize, and there are such forms and formats to each kind of book.
The economy needed, and the focus, the emphasis on action rather than exposition, and keeping things moving forward quickly, and keeping the young reader or viewer engaged emotionally and in terms of their imagination. It's very, very hard to do, and so it's a tremendously fun challenge.
But we're lucky. We have each other. Now I don't know how I would ever work without you. I mean that. And we finish each other's sentences and drink endless cups of tea when we write together and laugh a lot.
We do.
Yeah.
Well, it's the show is wonderful. Julie's Green Room. All three of you, all four of you. I'm sorry. I couldn't see you. Emma was leaning forward, so I couldn't.
It's okay.
Like, couldn't do it without any one of
that is
of
for
my
sure.
Greenies, Spike. So.
Oh, thank you.
I love you all very much.
And we love you.
We have thanks, and we have to thank Lisa for saying, would you like to do it?
Yes.
And giving us the freedom.
Letting us play.
And then,
thank you.
It sounds a little, well, never mind. Thank you, Netflix, for picking us up.
Binge the show.
Binge it. Lisa Henson,
always
Spike.
Take a puppet with you wherever you go.
That's right. Emma Walton, Hamilton.
Right?
Right.
Yeah.
And of course, Julie Andrews, thank you so much for being here.
Thank you.
That was wonderful.
Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you so much.